Mansark by Jane Austen. Audiobook 4x30. And the two Miss Snaids, with others of their acquaintance. I made my bow in form, and as Mrs. Snaid was surrounded by men, attached myself to one of her daughters, walked by her side all the way home, and made myself as agreeable as I could, the young lady perfectly easy in her manners, and as ready to talk as to listen. I had not a suspicion that I could be doing anything wrong. They looked just the same. Both well dressed, with veils and parasols like other girls, but I afterwards found that I had been giving all my attention to the youngest, who was not out, and had most excessively offended the eldest. Miss Augusta ought not to have been noticed for the next 6 months, and Miss Snaid, I believe, has never forgiven me. That was bad indeed. Poor Miss Snaid. Though I have no younger sister, I feel for her. To be neglected before one's time must be very vexatious, but it was entirely the mother's fault. Miss Augusta should have been with her governess. Such half and half doings never prosper. But now I must be satisfied about Miss Price. Does she go to balls? Does she dine out everywhere, as well as at my sister's? No, replied Edmund, I do not think she has ever been to a ball. My mother seldom goes into company herself, and dines nowhere but with Mrs. Grant, and Fanny stays at home with her. Oh! Then the point is clear. Miss Price is not out. Chapter 6 Mr. Bertram set off for, and Miss Crawford was prepared to find a great chasm in their society, and to miss him decidedly in the meetings which were now becoming almost daily between the families, and on their all dining together at the park soon after his going, she retook her chosen place near the bottom of the table, fully expecting to feel a most melancholy difference in the change of masters. It would be a very flat business, she was sure. In comparison with his brother, Edmund would have nothing to say. The soup would be sent round in a most spiritless manner, wine drank without any smiles or agreeable trifling, and the venison cut up without supplying one pleasant anecdote of any former haunch, or a single entertaining story, about my friend such a one. She must try to find amusement in what was passing at the upper end of the table, and in observing Mr. Rushworth, who was now making his appearance at Mansfield for the first time since the Crawfords' arrival. He had been